And now, for the man of the hour. I don't even know where do I begin. I'm beginning to be nervous now because the person I'm going to introduce, our first chief speaker, is such a great man. When I was reading what all he's done in life, I think I've drawn a lot of inspiration because the more I kept on reading, the more I wanted to go on YouTube and listen to what he was actually delivering to the world around. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce to you Mr. Madhusudan Kela, who is amongst us, the founder and chief of MK Ventures. Can we have a big round of applause, please? Mr. Kela is a master's degree holder in finance from the University of Mumbai. He formerly headed Reliance Capital as the chief investment strategist for 17 years. Currently, the founder and chief of MK Ventures, Mr. Kela, is a well-known face in the capital markets. He has been profiled by leading Indian and international magazines, including Forbes and Asia Money. His views are sought after by leading business channels in India, including CNBC TV 18, ET Now, Bloomberg, and CNBC Awaaz. He is a regular panelist for sharing investment views and opinion on a host of macroeconomic and thematic events. Mr. Kela also has contributed a lot towards the society and has been closely associated with Konark Cancer Foundation as well as the Isha Foundation. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and welcome Mr. Madhusudan Kela, who will take the stage now and take the evening further. Sir, please.
Hello. Good evening. Jai Sri Krishna. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you to Barjatya family for giving this honor to me. It's like homecoming. Nagpur is more or less like home. I know so many people, so many of my relatives and friends and well-wishers live here. It's actually an honor to come and be amongst all of you. Thank you for coming. So, you know, we typically give presentations which are more, I would say, bookish, polished, and not from the heart. But today I'm going to do something different. I think I am amongst people who are extremely well known to me, it is time to actually run through the last 25 years of my journey and share what worked and what did not work. You know, because a lot of knowledge is available. We live in an internet era, so nothing is hidden now. Everyone knows what is the value of moat. What did Warren Buffett say? What did Ramdev Agarwal say? What did Ramesh Damani say? And what did Rakesh Jhunjhunwala say? What are their investment mantras? How to look at balance sheet? How to calculate P multiple? How to look at businesses? A lot is being written. A lot is being spoken. A lot is also being spoken about the India story for last 10 years. So I thought, let's change the format. Let's only share what did I learn and how do I... What needs to be learned more, and how do I become wiser in the stock market? So the first learning is that it is your wisdom which makes money in the markets, not your knowledge. You know, knowledge is available to plenty of people, but it is you, as over a period of time, you become wise, and that is what makes a difference. Because this market actually is crazy, that you know you have Shree Cement trading at $300 per ton, and you have Mangalam Cement trading at $20 per ton. Both the companies are manufacturing cement. Now, how does an investor who only reads balance sheet decides that, you know, where to invest? And actually, if you bought a cheap company, we have seen it can remain cheap forever. And if you want an expensive company, it can get more and more expensive forever. And there are plenty of examples in the markets. So actually, it is the wisdom of last 25 years is what I would like to share. I hope it becomes beneficial to all of you and you carry something worthwhile home. Thank you so much. So to first start with, see, there is a world of difference between knowing what to do and actually doing it. It applies to all spheres of life and more importantly to stock markets. You know, vajan ghatana hai, sabko pata hai kya karna hai. Walk karna hai, fried nahi khana hai, Nilesh ko bhi pata hai. Par wo ghatta kitna hai, that is most important. So everyone in the world knows that, you know, this is what needs to be done and this is how it needs to be done, and if you do it, you will get the results. So jaise bhai sahab ne bola, don't do these five things. If you don't do that, obviously you will make money in the stock market. But when it actually comes to implementing, you know, you pledge your knowledge somewhere, you borrow someone's knowledge at that point of time because you want to get rich, you want to make quick money. So even though you know the principles, what not to do, but you will exactly do what is not to be done in the stock market. So everyone knows that, you know, there is hardly few people who have examples that you can make money in trading by being part-time in it. You know, I'm not commenting on people who do it full-time, but as far as I'm concerned, I have seen so many people who come, subhere aage acha hai, Bombay se tip aayi hai yaar, aaj ye lene ka hai. 5 minute phone lagaya aur share le liya. Phir kya hua, wo tip chali nahi, you know, 2-5% share ka bhav ghat gaya. Bombay wale ko phone kiya, bole bhai ye kya problem hai, tune subhere bola tha 5% ghat gaya. Bombay wale ne bola, nahi koi problem nahi hai, ye chalne wala hai, ye pakka, apna khabar ekdam pakka hai. Then next day comes, some global event happens, another 5% is gone. Then once it gone 20%, you will keep putting the money in the trade, you will keep putting the difference. When it goes to 30%, then you become long-term investor. So you bought something for trading, and then actually you became long-term investors. So you had no idea, you had no clue about that company. Someone gave you a tip, and you went ahead, implemented that tip, and then kept averaging. Now, all these things are written in a book that don't do this. Honest to God, please raise your hands. How many people still do it in Nagpur? I do it. So obviously, for whatever we go through here, we are going to just say that, you know, we'll end up learning and implementing what we learn, right? So, the second learning is that, you know, we always overestimate our capability to do something in the short term. And we always underestimate our capability to do something in the long run. I'll repeat again. We always end up overestimating what we can achieve in the short term. And we always underestimate what the possibilities in the long run are. Now look at what the possibilities in the long run are. Now this is not a data of Madhu Kela. This is a data which is being taken by most authentic sources. Now if you are an investor, and if you had like a 15-year time frame for being an investor in the markets, this is the kind of return which you would have generated in these companies. So let's say Bajaj Finance is up 471 times. 471 times in this time frame. UPL is up 267 times. Titan is up 244 times. Shri Cement is up 222 times, and the list goes on. And when these companies were investable, and some of them were investable 10 years back, 12 years back, 8 years back, 7 years back, market gave many opportunities to invest into these companies. It is not that it has become from point to point, it has given so much return. It has given many opportunities in between. But the starting point for most of these companies were that they were less than 1,000 crore rupees of market cap. This is the second list. Now, these are the list of companies which started with a mere 50 crore market cap. Again, the time frame is 15 years. Now, look at this list. There are companies which have gone even more than 2,000 times in 15 years. And some of them, as you can see from the list, there are many of them. So that is why, and I have personally seen this list, so this does not have a bias of a particular industry or a particular group, or it is actually, none of these companies actually belong to any major industrial group. Basically, it doesn't belong to Tata, Ambani, Birla, or, you know, some of the major groups. So when we look at this wealth creation and study what made these companies return what they returned, the point is that, you know, we don't end up appreciating what the possibilities in the long run are. While we are always focusing, kya lena hai, kab lena hai, bajar ghatega to lena hai kya, ye kab lena hai, aur ghatega ko lena hai, that is not the matter. The matter is only one, ki kitna lena hai aur kitne samay ke liye lena hai. So these days, you know, a lot of people are nervous in the last 1 month, what has happened in the market, including myself. Every portfolio is smashed out of shape, and a lot of people are looking that is it the end of the world, or is it very different this time than what has happened in the past. So I just wanted to share, you know, that it is not different. So the first, this is my conviction, and this is why I remain in the markets. So it has taken us, whatever, maybe 5,000 years to come to $2.4 trillion of GDP per annum, right? And in the next 10 years, in my view, this number will be close to $6 trillion. And in the next 20 years, this number will be more than $11, $12 trillion. So in other words, in a layman language, what has taken more than 5,000 years to come here in the history of India, much, much more excitement than that is going to happen over the next 20 years. So we are going to go from $2 trillion to $12 trillion in the next 20 years. Now again, as I say, we live in an age of internet era. You all can go and see countries which moved from $2 trillion to $10 trillion, and what happened to many industries, to many sectors, to many entrepreneurs, to many investors, and what kind of opportunity was there. Now, if you are a pessimist, you may believe that it will not happen in 20 years, it may happen in 25 years or 27 years. If you are an optimist, you may believe that it may happen in 18 years or 17 years. But I think there is no challenge to the direction of India's story and the growth in India. These are again supporting documents to say why this will happen. Enough time is being spent, so I will not spend. Now, this is where India is versus some of these countries which went through the $2 trillion to $10 trillion time. So, if you can see where India is, whether it is clothes or footwear, where the unit, I don't want to complicate it, just say that unit is 60, that was equivalent to where China was in 2004, and we are in 2018. And China today is at 239, Korea is at 662, and USA is at 924. And these are the various industries where India is lacking. And this is where China was in equivalent year where India today is. So as you can see, the gap is very, very large. In some cases, we are still in China as compared to 1990. So we are roughly 15, 20 years behind most of these developing countries which went through the GDP creation of $2 trillion to $4, $6 and $8 trillion. I think, you know, there is a lot of bad things which is spoken, a lot of there is there in media, there is a lot of skepticism about the current government. But what they have done definitely is these four things. They have made life simple for honest people because of GST. It is transparent, so when we speak to a lot of companies, we get a feeling that at least it has become far much more transparent than what it used to be in India. It is affluent and it is resilient. This is for near term. I think corporate earnings are going to grow at 14% CAGR. And in the past, we have seen wherever corporate earnings grow, you have reflection of that in the markets. So is this the first time markets are correcting? You can see I plotted it in the last 25 years. The reasons every time are different. Sometime it is 2008, which is the crisis of Lehman Brothers. Sometime it is Kargil War. Sometime it is X, sometime it is Y. The reasons are different, but markets find a way to correct and then bounce back because of the inherent strength of the country as well as of the companies which are there here. So again, no. So this is part two. So first is, how do you construct a portfolio? And what has been my key learning? So you having decided that the markets will always bounce back, but you don't make money by saying that India is going to do well. You don't make money by saying that this industry is going to do well. Aap paisa banate ho jab koi achhi company ya achhe stock mein aap paisa lagate ho. To the crux jo matter hai wo yahi hai ki aapke paas kaun si company hai aur kaun si industry pe aur kaun se entrepreneur pe aapne bet kiya. To jo maine list batai pehle, there are usme se 25 companies thi jinhone 100 se 2000% ka return diya. मैं आपको एक और लिस्ट बता सकता हूं जिसमें 2000 कंपनियां हैं जिन्होंने नेगेटिव रिटर्न दिया है यही टाइम फ्रेम पे इन द लास्ट 15 ईयर 2000 कंपनियों ने. तो 2000 कंपनियों में नेगेटिव रिटर्न है और 25 कंपनियों में पॉजिटिव रिटर्न है. तो एक्चुअली पिन पॉइंट कर पाना आप कौन सा स्टॉक खरीदना है और कितना खरीदना है, दैट इज रियल आर्ट ऑफ इन्वेस्टिंग. अभी ये क्या है प्रॉब्लम, सब लोगों को ये बहुत आसान लगता है that you know किसी से टिप मिल जाएगी, कोई बैलेंस शीट पढ़ लेगा, अपन किसी CFO को किसी कंपनी में जानते हैं वो अपने को खबर दे देगा, कोई चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट अपने को समझा देगा. पर मैं बोलता हूं आपको 25 साल में मैंने सीखा है ये बहुत ही कठिन काम है और पूरा हिंदुस्तान इसी पे लगा हुआ है, इंक्लूडिंग द पीपल आर रनिंग द कंपनी. वो भी अपना शेयर खरीदना चाहते हैं, उसका अकाउंटेंट भी चाहता है कि मेरा स्टेक कंपनी में होना चाहिए, वो बाबू भी चाहता है कि मेरे पास 75% होना चाहिए, और वो लोग भी फेल हो जाते हैं. तो अगर आप 2008 में देखो, दुनिया के पूरे शानों ने वारंट ले लिया. आई डोंट वांट टू नेम ए पर्सन, पर आप जाके 2008 का गूगल देख लो, कितने सारे लोगों ने अपनी कंपनी का वारंट लिया था और वो सब कंपनी वाले को सब खबर था ऐसा हो जाएगा वैसा हो जाएगा. बट द फैक्ट ऑफ द मैटर इज 2008 में सब शानों ने वारंट लेने के बाद वो वारंट का पैसा डूब गया. व्हाट हैपेंड टू द मार्केट वाज अ वेरी डिफरेंट थिंग. So first is that you have to choose the portfolio right. So in choosing the portfolio, I would just say what works for me. What works for me, first is there is a bull run always everywhere going on. Somewhere there is a bull run which is going on in the market. So let's say if you are convinced that India is not going to do well 1 year back, oil prices are going to rise, right? Current account deficit is going to rise. Then you will have a pressure on the currency. If you are convinced that yes, this is the reality, now you have to look at ki isse bull run kahan pe aayega. So clearly you saw in this time frame, TCS has given 100% return. Infosys has given almost 80% return. So many pharma companies are up between 30 to 50%. So one way is saying, "Arey baapre, mar gaye yaar, India ka to kuch nahi hone wala hai." Because ABCD has happened, currency has gone to 75, everything is closed down. But when the effect and there is a reflection of that effect somewhere. So if you believe that there is a bull run which is going on somewhere, every time, then you will be focused to identify that portion of the market which is going to do well. Then it is prudent capital allocation. And this is where I have lost a lot of money personally. We lost a lot of money in our fund. So what happens, you know, when you get convinced that this is a particular thing which is going to do exceedingly well, you allocate disproportionate amount of your wealth. And for some time, actually, it works beautifully. And you get really gung-ho, and you get overboard. And there comes a time, then even 50, 60% of your portfolio gets into that particular group or particular stocks. That is dangerous. You have to make sure that there is absolute balance in your portfolio. So at some point of time, you'll have to keep cutting your winners to achieve that balance. Because you never know what goes wrong, even in most brilliant companies. Like, could you have ever imagined that Kodak will become nil 25 years back? Could you have ever imagined that Nokia will become nil 25 years back? Could we have ever thought ki post office or MTNL ka ye hal ho jayega in 20 years? No, right? So what changes comes, you never know. The only way to protect against these changes is to make sure that you have proper allocation to your portfolio. Third is choosing the right horse. Now, and choosing the right jockey. Now, these are not written anywhere in the book. These are my own learnings, so I put it verbatim. So what has worked for me, that, you know, if you choose the right entrepreneur, and if you choose the right business, you may temporarily go wrong or right, but in the long run, you will really emerge as winner. Now, let me give you an example. Like, you know, there are so many banks in India which are there. Why is it that HDFC Bank only has created disproportionate wealth for its investors? If you look back, there was a real jockey in the form of Aditya Puri who actually has delivered that for investors. So whenever we see a big success, and this can be seen even in the wealth creators which I pointed out, invariably you will have extremely strong management which is driving these businesses. So if you choose the right business and then the right entrepreneur and the right management, I think majority of the work is done. Then you have to just sit, relax, and allow the time to pass and allow the company to perform. It's very easy to say, it's very easy, you know, to say that, yeah, so what is so difficult in choosing the right entrepreneur and choosing the right right sector? But that is the most difficult part. Then if you have it, and if you really get convinced, then you have to really bet big in the beginning itself. Because if you get it right, and you put 1% of your capital into this combination, you know, one will become five. But still in a portfolio, it will be 100 out of five. If you ever get it, and trust me, when you get it, you will be in minority. It will not be that 100 people will coincide with you and say that, yes, what you are saying is right. You will be in absolute minority at that point of time. But if you are convinced, then you have to bet big. The second thing is about investment timing and considerations. A lot of people hate bear markets, or you hate these kind of corrections, you know. In fact, people like us who are professional investors, we love these kind of corrections. Because it only these kind of corrections do you really get value for your investment, and you get to choose right companies at right valuations. Obviously, you know, you cannot invest in any company without doing a proper homework of yours. I am repetitively telling you this. And if you don't have the competence to understand markets, if you don't have the competence to do the homework yourself and understand there are so many good professional people who are available, who have such a splendid track record over 15, 20, 25 years. In fact, not at the cost of boosting, when I was in Reliance Mutual Fund, our Reliance Growth Fund went up from 12 rupees NAV to 1100 rupees NAV in matter of 15 years. So we made more than 100 time returns for investors who stayed with us for a period of 15 years. So if you think that you don't have it yourself and you can't do it yourself, please don't try it. Like if you get sick and really get sick, you don't try to get medicine yourself. If you fall into a legal problem, you don't try to go become a lawyer yourself. You know, like it's like if you are a serious investor and you want to put some serious money on the markets, you can't be very casual about it. Chalo koi bol dega aur main kar lunga. Then, you know, the third part is how do you monitor companies? So you invest properly, but you have to monitor because a lot can change into a portfolio overnight. Specifically, now in times where we are living, you know, overnight something happens, some disruption happened. Like, you know, what happened? NBFC companies were absolute darlings of the stock market for 5 years. In 2 weeks, it looks like there is no bad sector like NBFC. And now everyone has become wise that, you know, are asset liability mismatch, ye kisko nahi pata chala kya? How come no one came and told us in TV here that there could be an ALM mismatch? The fact is that many people were aware, but if you were monitoring it very carefully, maybe you would not have got at the peak, but you will be aware that such a concern can happen and you had the possibility of reacting to such a thing. And my belief is that I come in the stock market for making money. I don't come here to be right. I'll repeat, you know, a lot of people come here to be right, saying that maine aapko ye bola tha. Are tune kiya kya tha, bhai? There is no point saying that maine aapko 5 saal pehle ye lene ko bola tha, 10 saal pehle is company mein maine research kiya tha. The fact is that jo aapne bola ya jo kisi ne aapko bola, did you implement that and did you make money out of that? Then only it is worth being in the markets. The second point is that, you know, sometimes people become too theoretical about investing. And you say that, you know, I will look at X, I will look at Y, I will look at Z, I will look at all the parameters, but by the time you look at, the opportunity is gone. One more important thing is on a portfolio monitoring is the art of selling. So I have read thousands of books on how to buy, when to buy, what to buy, how to choose an industry. But I'm yet to come across a book which says how to sell and when to sell. You know, it's a very tough job because if you're too early, you can miss a lot of gains. If you're too late, you can get stuck in your portfolio. If you are in love with an entrepreneur, you can get stuck. If you don't have access, still you may come out early. So the art of selling is not again about basically saying that, you know, koi share 20 taka badh gaya ya koi share ka P multiple 20 ke upar ho gaya to bech dene ko hai. You know, maximum amount of money actually is being made when a share goes up above 25 P multiple, because then it goes from the realm of value investors, and then a lot of momentum investors only come into those kind of stocks. And I have seen even in 2001-2, you know, the technology stocks like Infosys went into 150 P. So when to sell, you will see a euphoria. And I can assure you, a good person, a guy who sells the stock right, is a guy who is convinced that after I will sell, and the stock will definitely go up. Someone who is trying to catch the top will never be able to catch the top. So you have to be able to sell and digest that after I sell, let it go up. It doesn't matter. Then, you know, some of this is not quantitative, but it is more qualitative, which is behavioral science. That patience and long-term mindset is a must for investing. Where we have identified a lot of perception gap, I'll spend 2 minutes here for people who love stock selection and See, sometimes a perception of a management is very, very bad. But when you look at the reality, it is not that bad. But many a time people go with the perception, ki a fraud hai, ye cheat hai, that you know this management is not good. While the numbers and the performance is telling you something completely different. In the last 15 years, I have personally identified many such companies where there is a huge perception gap, both positive as well as negative. So positive is when it is perceived very bad and stock is available very cheap. And you make a lot of money as the investors catch up with the reality. And it has happened with many large groups. It has happened with many smaller companies with the perception. Because, you know, people create their own biases in the stock market. Ek bari aapko lag gaya na ki ye fraud hai, wo aapke dimag se jana bahut kathin kaam hai. Wo kuch kiya ho ya na kiya ho. Then for him to become honest in your mind is a very tough job. And that is what creates that perception. Over a period of time, you obviously make some mistakes also when you take this kind of bets. But I have seen when the reality is very good and the perception is bad, you end up actually making a lot of money. Why vice versa, when the perception is phenomenal and the numbers are not coming and it's only a story, ye quarter nahi, agle quarter, agle quarter nahi, agle quarter, agle quarter nahi, agle quarter. So kabhi na kabhi wo phir quarter nahi aata hai aur doobi jata hai. So, you know, Nilesh told me that there are a lot of people who are traders here. I am not a trader, neither I have real any advice to give you as a trader. But since I am here, I just thought, let me recollect from one of my trading friends as to how they do it. So I am just merely communicating what works for them. So if you are a trader, first of all, you know, what you should do, Mr. Barjatya, there are a lot of very, very good professional traders. So like you are doing this investing seminar, you should do a trader's carnival here. Trust me, there are a lot of very good people who understand trading, who understand options, future. Now, you know, you and I can't change the world. We have to accept people will end up trading, irrespective of how much we speak. So it was, might as well give them the best access as you are in this business. So I think there are two most important things in trading. One I spoke already, that whenever it is a full-time job, don't do it part-time, don't do it on the basis of tips, don't do it on the basis of casual thing. Second thing is, always have stop-loss. Now, this is being told by best of my friends who have been extremely successful in trading, that you always, when you do an investment, you need not have a stop-loss. But when you do a trade, you have to have a stop-loss. And third is, that when a stop-loss hits, you have to sell it. You may get into that trade again. So then you will not end up averaging a bad trade and you will not end up, you know, being a long-term investor in a trading stock. And fourth is that please do not do trading beyond your capacity. So do not excessively leverage. We come across so many stories every day in our professional career. The people who come in the stock market, but they will curse the markets that, you know, it's all of ye satta nu dhando hi khoto che, but wo learn karenge after losing their shirts. But why did they lose so much money? Because actually they ended up disproportionately trading and taking bets which were beyond their means. I'll just spend 5 minutes that, you know, this is the theme which I'm most bullish on in the next 10 years. So I believe there is a lot of disruption which will happen. And billions and trillions of dollars of wealth will get created over the next 10, 15 years because of these disruptions. And similarly, billions of dollars of wealth will get destroyed if you are on the wrong side of this disruption. So let's say, just start with a, you know, so what are the disruptions which we can already see? We can see an Uber and Ola, which is actually replacing so many taxis, and so many taxi companies have been replaced or getting slowly replaced over the last 5 years. So you have seen a company like Uber being valued at more than $100 billion. And so many of these traditional companies which are offering taxi services their valuations have gone this way. Airbnb, Oyo versus a lot of hotel companies. It is actually astonishing to see Oyo's valuation being higher than Indian hotels. You know, Oyo being valued at 15,000 crores and Indian hotels market cap is maybe 10 or 12,000 crores. Then again, in electrical vehicle space, what is Tesla in BYD? So Tesla is at $60 or $80 billion, BYD is at $25 billion, and you know what the valuation of Mercedes, BMW, and GEs of this world are. 3D printing, we see all the time what is Netflix doing to our day-to-day life, and what is the impact of this on a traditional media. So I see, you know, my wife watching a series, now she doesn't have to wait at 9 o'clock every night that some episode will happen. So it is happening like every hour, whenever you want, you can watch it in Netflix, whatever movie which you want. And this pace is actually gathering a lot of momentum. Then you have seen what has happened to Alibaba, Amazon, Flipkart. So what I'm saying, these are very, very interesting graphs. This is a technology absorption and the number of years it has taken for various technologies to become part of our life, right? So for telephone, which was invented in 1900, it took almost 50 years for it to become an integral part of our lives. And you can see what happened to electricity, what happened to car, what happened to radios. Lot of these inventions for our to get penetrated in our lives took an amazing amount of time, which is anywhere ranging between 10 years to 50 years. But the last invention of tablet got absorbed in 6 months. So you can know now what technology can do to your lives, to your fortunes, to your financial portfolios, and to the businesses in which you are operating. So a lot of people who are business people, you know, more than the stock market tip or anything, you have to make sure that you are on the not on a wrong side of the business where there is a lot of disruption which is happening. And if you are on the wrong side of the business, obviously, you know, a lot of people are saying, "Nahi, humko nahi farak padega. Kisko aur farak padega to pad jayega. Humko nahi farak padega." So this is basically you are living in a denial. आपको दिख रहा है कि तूफान सामने से आ रहा है, आप सामने खड़े हो, बोले नहीं उसका घर निकल गया, मैं तो खड़ा रहूंगा, तूफान मेरे बाजू से निकल जाएगा. ऐसा नहीं होने वाला है. एंड आई थिंक टेक्नोलॉजी इज गोइंग टू डिसरप्ट एंड क्रिएट मच मच मोर वेल्थ एंड डिसरप्ट मच मच मोर वेल्थ देन व्हाट एनीवन कैन इमेजिन एंड थिंक टुडे. एंड दिस इज ऑल गोइंग टू हैपन इन माय व्यू इन द नेक्स्ट 10 to 15 ईयर्स. Sorry. Now, you know, I just had one slide on the invention of technology and what is the impact of it, which happened in the last 10 years. So something as simple as internet has created some guy who understood what internet is going to do 15 years back. He had to do nothing. He had to do nothing, I'm saying. He had to only invest invest on companies which are getting benefited out of internet as a platform. So roughly $15 trillion of wealth has got created in the last 15 years by internet alone in the world. $15 trillion, out of which you have $1 trillion by Amazon, $1 trillion by Apple. So these are not companies which would have been successful had the internet story not being so ingrained and become so popular. So if you actually understood what technology can do by going by the past also, and if we can catch one trend in our lifetime, I think we'll make money for next 7 generations. Only one trend is what we have to catch. So I just thought, let me share some of the themes which I like, which has that power to become through the technology disruption, that these themes, in my view, present that power. I don't know whether they will be successful, they will go the full way or not. There are so many technologies which come, but don't go the full way. They get died in between also. So one of the things which I like when we are doing a lot of work is on electrical vehicles. So I feel that the cost of battery, which used to be $1,000 just 10 years back, has fallen to $200. When it goes to $100 per pack, then you will not leave any government subsidy, which means all traditional vehicles can be replaced with electrical vehicle, potentially. Now, even if 10% of those vehicles get replaced, it is going to be billions of dollars of industry and billions of dollars of market. Now, the early sign of this is very visible. So if you see the Chinese market, there are so many cities in China which have become pure electrical vehicle. There is no bus, there is no cumbersome engine bus in these cities. So I think, now, you know, don't blame me, don't hold me, ki Madhu Kela bol ke gaya electrical vehicle, kal koi bhi electrical vehicle ka jaka stock mat khari lena, because these are things, it can take much, much longer than what you can think today. I have the patience and I have the energy and I have possibly the money to take this risk. So I am pursuing some of these themes going by my past of learning this. Some of you who want to even look at these businesses as a business person should also explore these themes. I think this is all, a lot of gyan is there, so I'll leave this presentation. So the people who are more interested in a deeper knowledge, they can go through it. This is just a small theme which I think, again, in the stock market, you don't have to be right from a 15-year perspective. Even if you're right in a 5-year perspective, you actually can end up making a lot of money. So there is one thing which we have studied for last 6-9 months where we find there is some potential going forward, at least in a 3-5-year time frame. It is basically the API business of the pharmaceutical side. So a lot of capacity is getting challenged because of the environmental reason in China, and a lot of capacity will shift and is starting to shift into India. Once those capacities get shifted, obviously it will be extremely beneficial for the companies which are operating in this particular space. Now a lot of these capacities got shifted to China because of the cost advantage, and because of that very reason, it is coming back to India. So I'll just give you, you know, a small snapshot. Now these are some of the API products where prices have risen anywhere between 100% to 300% in the last 1 year. And this is because of the China angle. And this is why I told you that this is not a casual job. This is not something which you can do part-time. Even when we do it full-time, and we do it with so much hard work and passion, still our strike rate is only 50% of being right. Right? So now these are the drugs name where the prices have risen. So now when we identify this, then we look at which are the companies which manufacture this drug and what kind of benefit can happen to these companies. I'm not getting into detail. The third theme which I like is fintech, which is essentially challenging the way traditional financial services space is working. So it is challenging the very big banks worldwide. It is challenging a lot of conglomerates which are operating in the financial services space, because they are nimble, they are technology driven, they can deliver you. See, the fact is that so many people are amazed that Bajaj Finance is more than 1 lakh crore market cap company, and so many banks today in India do not have 1 lakh crore market cap. So there is, this whole thing is divided into two parts among even intelligent investors, and there is no clear cut conviction which one is going to win. So I am on the other side. I think fintech is here to stay. I think they will end up disrupting banking and financial services, and as time passes by, you will have a lot of companies create a lot of wealth, and also a lot of wealth will get destroyed. So with this, I will end by saying that it was fantastic. I am sorry if my presentation was technical for a lot of people. I tried to make it as simple as possible. I would close by saying that have faith in this country. Have faith in your own approach of investing. Take a view. Invest small money without leverage and leave it for 10, 15, 20 years. I hope I'll get another chance and many people will share their success story of investment next time when I'm here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. That was phenomenal. I must repeat that it's your wisdom and not your knowledge that takes you further. And if you're trying to catch the top, it'll never happen. We do have a common belief even in our office when, you know, a lot of customers keep on telling us, "Wo maine har baar high pe kyun nahi becha? Tu jab bolta hai bechne ke, uske baad pakka badh jata hai. Aur jab bolta hai ki khareed le, uske baad pakka gir jata hai." That's a common phenomenon, ladies and gentlemen. It's not only something that happens with only the two of us. It's with all of us. And lastly, have faith in this country, have faith in yourself while you're investing. Always believe that whenever you're investing, invest into value creation.